decision.
Thank you.
everyone here, right?
Yes, sir.
Yes. All rise. State Court, Fulton County is now in session. The Honorable Judge Pinkie, T. Toomer, presiding. Court back on order.
No, not quite, but good afternoon, everyone. Probate court is in order.
Probate,
I know you're all over the courthouse. Can you open the door for the staff attorney? Take your seats. Good afternoon, everyone.
Good afternoon, Your Honor.
The four deputies go from one courtroom to another.
I was in the case, and the case was called a trial.
the claims that were going to trial were as follows. If I can find the paragraph in the pretrial order. Okay. The claims that I was representing Ms. Kingery was a conversion claim on behalf of this state, meaning that Fredy Alvarez was being sued for converting or taking some property that had belonged to their mother before she died. And because she was dead, that claim was part of the estate, was a claim of the estate. And because Ms. Kingery already had these other claims of her own against Mr. Alvarez, the administrator, whoever that was at the time, gave her the authority to bring those claims. Also, there was a battery claim abroad on behalf of the estate where Ms. McKingery alleged that Mr. Alvarez had committed a battery against their mother when she was alive. Also, there were two claims for intentional infliction of emotional distress, one on behalf of the estate for acts that I don't recall, but something along the line of threats or threatening statements that would cause emotional distress that were brought on behalf of the state. There was also a claim for intentional infliction of emotional stress brought on behalf of Maria Kingery for statements and actions of Mr. Alvarez. Those were the four legal claims. And then I believe there were some counterclaims that were brought by the defendant, which we contended were either time barred or they weren't played in time. I know, for example, he claimed that she had slandered him. There was a defamation claim that she had brought it, a counterclaim. And there's only a 1-year statute of limitations on that. Plus, it's a compulsory counterclaim, which should have been brought within 30 days unless there was a court order. So our contention was that was out of time. But see, none of this stuff ever got to trial. He also claimed that she had tortiously interfered with contracts, contractual business relations of him. And he also claimed that Ms. Kingery had ejected him from real property, I guess the mother's home, and claimed that she had also converted some property herself or funds. And he even claimed that she had assaulted and battered him. And he also claimed that she had unduly influenced their mother. And what happened is we came down and we took the jury, and some of these claims probably would have been dealt with on a directed verdict motion, something like that. We never got to that point because once we picked the jury, Judge Eady took the parties, not the lawyers, but just the parties back to chambers, and then they worked out some kind of stuff.
Being unresponsive to the question, the question is, what did he represent Mrs. Alvarez for?
I agree. I represent her on the claim.
Thank you.
Yeah. All right. Okay. Sorry about that.
That's
right. Thank you. I will, what I'm going to say is that I, in further response, I represented Ms. Kingery on the claims that she and the state brought against Mr. Alvarez in the state court of Fulton County, and also defended her on the claims that Mr. Alvarez brought.
And her. What was the outcome of that litigation?
The outcome of that litigation was that there was a settlement made on the day of trial, which was actually mediated by Judge Eady. It was reduced to writing in open court, and it was announced in open court on the record.
Okay. And there was an actual handwritten settlement agreement? Yeah. I know you have it in your possession,
yes,
sir, but it's also in evidence in court from
Okay. Judges
here.
So. Yes.
And specifically, as part of your participation in the case or the mediation or the settlement, was there ever any settlement of any creditors' claims in the probate court or any other probate court in state court litigation?
I had no, I made no appearance in probate court. I had nothing to do with the probate court.
Okay. I want to show you what's been marked as M42. Judge, I apologize for that. I don't know. Don't take it.
M42, okay.
You recognize that document?
Just be glad he didn't bring you in 1-41. yes, this is an affidavit that I voluntarily gave because at one point in this dispute, I was being asked to give a deposition. And I offered to do an affidavit instead of a deposition. Yeah.
Your Honor, I want to tender M42, who's identified as it on that day.
Did you get a copy?
Yes, Your Honor.
Okay.
Your Honor, I brought three copies of each exhibit, and I'll just read them as court directs.
Okay, I'd like one, but I think Mr. Spears has.
I'm going to object to the affidavit. Mr. Jones is here to testify. There's no reason for us to enter an affidavit of his that offers his opinion as to what happened in a document that's in exhibit. The document speaks for itself, and Mr. Jones is here. I don't think he gets it. I don't think his affidavit has any bearing on this case. Not that to it.
Mr. Do you have a response?
I do. I might need to board our just a little bit more about the exhibit, John, if I could.
Okay.
Or let that for the foundation, I guess it's better.
Okay. Question.
Mr. Jones, that's all that's in the affidavit. What prompted you not to draft that affidavit?
I was asked. At this point, I was no longer representing Ms. Kingery because that lawsuit was over. And I guess this was approximately a year later, maybe more than a year later, I was asked to
provide
some testimony on this dispute here.
Did you understand that there had been an allegation made that the probate court claims or some of the probate court claims have been resolved in the state court case?
I wasn't aware of the allegations. I just knew there was a dispute in the probate court, and I was being asked to provide testimony about the extent of the state court. So,
whose request did you execute that?
Ms. Kingery.
Yes. Okay.
She actually wanted me to sit for a deposition, and I offered to give an affidavit instead. And my feeling was that wasn't necessary because I thought the documents spoke for themselves as far as the contracts and the record of the court.
So I'm understanding your affidavit relates to what you believe was settled in the state court?
And what was discussed, I mean, in terms of what the effect of the settlement and the fact that there was a meeting of the minds.
I'm going to allow his affidavit in, subject to my reviewing it anyway. I don't think it has much weight because I agree with Mr. Spears. He's here to give testimony and bolstering his observations about what was settled in the state court is not something that's required. We've got the state court, the actual order, the settlement agreement and the order entered by Judge Eady.
Yes,
so
I
am hesitant to believe that this attorney's observations about what the settlement covered or not makes any difference.
It's merely offered to rebut Mr. Alvarez's testimony on Thursday that they had resolved everything in state court and his sister was being unreasonable about maintaining the credit.
I'm going to allow it, subject to the observation I just made.
Thank you.
You can go ahead.
Thank you. So, at some point in time, did you receive some correspondence about the probate court case?
I believe at one point I was copied on some correspondence of one of the lawyers in the estate matter had copied me on, and I believe it. I'm not certain. It may have been Mr. Alvarez because whoever did it just copied me as a courtesy because of this litigation that I had represented them on, and they just added me to the distribution list and actually notified the court that take me off the distribution list because I was not a counsel record in the probate court.
Initiative was marked M43. Recognize that document?
Yeah, this is the letter that I sent to the probate court. It is a letter dated September 3rd, 2014.
True and correct copy of the letter you sent?
Yes.
Yeah, September 43.
An objection?
Your Honor, I've got one general objection.
Okay, so please say it.
We have an affidavit, which is not listed in the pretrial information. We have a letter, which is not entered in the pretrial information. We have a lot of witnesses who is. I object to all of these things, and we were not given notice of ahead of time.
Thank you. Without even your response, he is absolutely correct. Sustained. Move on.
Mr. Jones, I'm tempted to address the question.
I'm sorry?
Your Honor, can I say something to you that I think is responsive to the last question of the bank? Being assistance to you?
No.
Okay.
Thank you. Thanks, Leo.
Mr. Jones, at any time while the state court litigation was going on, did you have a perception that you were also negotiating or litigating any of the private court claims?
Not at all. Someone else was handling that completely.
That's all questions I have for Mr. Jones.
All right. Anything on thoughts? Oh, Mr. Alvarez. You first, Bill. Thanks.
Mr. Jones.
Yeah, thank you.
Good afternoon, Mr. Jones.
Good afternoon.
Mr. Jones, prior to representation of Mrs. Kingery, was, as far as you know, represented by anybody else?
I believe she was. I just don't remember who.
If I give you the name of Egan Fettle, would that refresh your recollection?
Well, I believe he represented her at some point, but I think someone else was representing her at the time that I was involved.
Yes, sir.
Prior to that.
Yes, sir. And how about Harmon Caldwell?
Mr. Caldwell, or at least someone in his firm, was involved. I can't remember if they were handling the litigation or if they were involved in the probate court.
And Jeremy Moser?
I don't know that name.
Theodore Erk?
Theodore Erk?
Yes, sir.
The name sounds vaguely familiar, but I don't have any recollection of that had been involved.
Yes, sir. Now, I'm going to show you the document that we previously introduced as Fredy 1. And you have seen that document before,
correct? Yes. Yes.
And that is the document that was prepared in state court.
Yes, I believe it's in your lawyer's handwriting.
And yes, sir, but your signature is on the document. Well,
that's correct.
And your client's Mrs. Kingery's signature is there.
That's correct.
And mine is there as well.
Yes.
And Judge Edie's signature is there.
Yes.
And you and your client reviewed that document before the document was signed. Is that correct?
That's correct.
And you advised her regarding whether she should sign or not the document at the time?
I don't think that I can testify about what I advised her, but my recollection is that Judge Edie announced that the parties had reached a settlement, and then he called all of us back in the chambers, including the lawyers, and then we wrote down what the terms that had been agreed upon.
And everyone acknowledged to Judge Edie that they were in agreement with the document.
That's correct.
And that the document was submitted to the court.
That's correct. It was filed that day.
And do you recall telling Judge Eady when we went back in chambers. You recall going back in chambers with your client, my attorney, Mr. Digger.
Yes.
And Judge Eady being present as well?
Yes.
And you recall me insisting that I would not settle the case unless all controversies were settled.
I don't have any specific recollection of that. I mean, I know you signed this agreement, which was all
that's
the probate in the state court.
Yes, sir. And
the state court wouldn't have had jurisdiction over anything pending the probate court.
Okay. Now, let's go back to M42.
Is the court has a copy of M42?
No, that's the affidavit.
It has been submitted into evidence, Judge, I believe.
Actually,
this
is the exhibit, so.
I'm not sure it was tendered.
This is the affidavit.
Right, M42.
That was the one you said you're not allowed for limited purposes of the reserve room.
Right, okay. That's the one Mr. Spears objected to.
Well, I have a copy of it.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah.
And I don't have it.
I've got
you to the
court.
Okay.
I'm gonna, I'm going to hand you M42. And let me bring your attention to paragraph 3.
Yes.
In paragraph 3, would you read paragraph 3?
Paragraph 3 says, early on during my representation of Maria Kingery, I learned that she was in disagreement with the appointed administrator's payment of expenses and overall administration of the Alvarez estates.
So, you knew that Mrs. Kingery was in disagreement with the way the administrator was handling the expenses?
I knew that if she had some expenses that she expected to be reimbursed.
And I
don't know any of the specifics. I just know that there was an ongoing issue and that would ultimately be resolved in the probate court. It would be up to the administrator to decide what expenses what not to pay, that would be subject to review by the probate court.
But your information was regarding the state court, correct? What you stated there in paragraph 3, I learned that you was in disagreement with the appointed administrator's payment of expenses.
I knew that she had issues. I didn't know specifically what they were, whether they had to do with payment of expenses being paid, or either she wanted something paid that wasn't paid or something was paid that she disagreed with.
But that was in the state court of Fulton County.
No, that was in the probate court.
In the probate court of Fulton County.
Right, and I don't even know if it was actually anything on record. I just knew that because, you know, returns get filed at certain points if they're required. And I don't know whether anything was actually before the court. I just knew that she had a general dissatisfaction.
Yes, sir.
The administrator, I don't even think it's the same administrator. Yes. A different administrator was handling the case.
But there was not an administrator in the state court case.
No, there was not an administrator in the state court case. Certain claims of the administrator have been assigned, but those were only those claims that I mentioned, the claims for conversion and intentional infliction, motion stress, and the battery.
And there was no property held from the estates of Federico Alvarez and Graciela Alvarez in the state court.
No, that would be completely outside the state.
Let me bring your attention. Yes, sir. Let me bring your attention to paragraph 6 of your affidavit. Would you read that paragraph?
The settlement agreement filed with the Fulton County State Court only addressed the civil claims and counterclaims asserted by Maria Kingery and Fredy Alvarez against one another in said court.
Okay. Now, let's go back, Mr. Jones, to Fredy's Exhibit 1. Paragraph 2 and 3 of Fredy's Exhibit 1, they deal with attorney fees of the parties, attorney fees in the state court, correct?
In the state court.
And the style of the case refers to Kingery and I, correct?
Yes.
Those are the parties?
Yes.
Now, paragraph 4 states the claims and counterclaims before the state court are dismissed with prejudice, pretty much.
Yes.
And paragraph 5, it says any future claims that have been brought in the action are forever waived. It refers to the state court, correct?
It says any claim is basically just stating the principle of res judicata, anything that was litigated or which could have been litigated in the instant action, that is, in this case, in state court.
In the state court.
Were resolved.
Not in any other court.
No.
Now, let's visit paragraph 1. It says, and I quote, the plaintiff and the defendant, that is Mrs. Kingery and I, correct?
Yes.
Shall share equally, that means 50%, 50-50, correct?
Yes.
The proceeds of the estate property contained within the estates of Federico Alvarez and Graciela Alvarez, correct?
Yes.
That refers to the state court.
Right, well, that is saying that the consideration for the settlement of the state court claims would be your respective shares of the estate. And as I understood it, y'all were the only two heirs and y'all took equal shares. So, once the administrator had paid whatever expenses and costs needed to be paid out of the estate, the net proceeds that would be split 50-50, that was what you were supposed to inherit anyway. And basically, the agreement and consideration for dropping all these claims was that y'all would not change that. Because the assets that would have been available to satisfy the judgment would have come out of your shares of the estate anyway.
Yes, but he refers to
it was a mutual surrender is what it was.
Right, but he refers to the property that's being held in the state court and the probate court. I'm sorry, the probate court, correct? Of the estates.
It's referring to that.
Okay.
But it's, right.
Let's continue.
It's not disposing of any property.
Right, let's continue. Less any expenses awarded by the administrator.
Yeah, and I interpret less as meaning separate and apart from.
Yeah. After the administrator had paid expenses.
Right.
Whatever expenses the administrator paid, 50-50.
Right.
So, going back to exhibit M42, then paragraph 6, not correct, is it?
It is correct, because this settles the claims and counterclaims by essentially saying that the consideration for those claims would be the inheritance, and that we would essentially pursue each other to collect this
settlement
and this lawsuit.
Settling the state court cases.
Yes.
Okay. Now, let me ask you something. Did your client tell you that the administrator already had proposed how he was going to pay the expenses in the probate case, court case?
I shouldn't say what my client told me. Anything my client told me would have been a confidence. However, I don't have any recollection of that, although I'm sure that she told me about it.
Okay.
I just don't remember any specifics. Okay. Nor do I want to open the door and talk about it.
Right. I understand. That is her privilege. Now, that's all I have, sir.
Okay. Thank you.
Mr. Spears, do you have something on the house?
Very briefly, Your Honor.
Okay.
Mr. Jones, I'm John Spears. Quick question. Paragraph 3 of 31, which is the consent settlement agreement, says the plaintiff and the defendant shall be responsible for their own attorney's fees incurred. Talking about all the attorney's fees in the state court case. Is that correct?
That's right. Because they asserted claims for fees as part of the bad faith.
Yes. All their claims for fees that are related to the state court case. Correct?
Yes.
Thank you. No more questions.
All right. You can step down, sir.
Thank you.
Now.
We have objection, Mr. Jones.
That was my next question.
Sorry.
Mr. Jones, you're excused.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right.
Appreciate your time.
Good luck to all of you.
Thank you.
You have another witness?
I'm calling Skinner, Judge.
Okay.
Your side. what Mr. Meester told her is inadmissible hearsay. Mr. Meester's not here. It's a statement made by a declarant who is not present.
Just saying.
Thank
you. Go ahead. Hold on.
May I ask that question?
Yes.
Okay. Did you have an understanding from your own investigations or conversations with people involved in your case about the circumstances of the real estate?
Yes, I was told.
Don't tell me what you were told. Tell me what you understand and what you believe.
I understand, according to the administrator, that there were taxes passed due because the exemptions were lifted once he took over. And the administrator, and actually there's a letter from him saying time is of the essence, this has to be paid. He even requested whether I and my brother would pay $3,000 each, and he said this has to be paid this month, January 14th. Otherwise, the property will be foreclosed upon. And I understood, I was specifically told it would be sold on the steps of the courthouse. So I went crazy. This is my parents' home. How could this be? And so that's the reason I agreed reluctantly, and it wasn't my decision, to put the house on the market.
What specifically led you to believe that the house is going to be foreclosed upon?
The administrator's letter and my own attorney's words from the administrator in his letter saying the house had to be, the taxes, and there is a letter from him, had to be paid during the month of May, or there would be a foreclosure. In addition to that, he requested whether my son, who was leasing the property at the time and was also there as a caregiver protecting the 90-year-old home, he requested whether he would be willing to pay $1,000. My reply was yes, he would, but the administrator never responded. My son moved out when the property was placed on the market because he did not want to stay there with people coming in and out of the home. He had a dog, etc. But he would have paid, and there would have been enough money to pay the taxes. Plus, later, I saw a letter from Attorney Wood, much later, which I was not aware of, saying you have 1 to 2 years before any foreclosure or anything happened to that home. Too late by then.
So you're dissatisfied that you were led to believe that there was a sense of urgency in selling the house because of the taxes?
Absolutely, and this was at a time when the market had crashed, and as I said, there was none of the issues were resolved.
So are you led to believe that there were defects in the property after it was listed by the real estate agent?
Yes, and I need to be able to present these emails because I believe this is key to the case, since my witness was not allowed to testify. If I may,
hold on a second. Mr. Spears, you're on your feet.
I'm sorry, Your Honor. I'm going to object to any exhibit that is not listed in the pretrial submission.
I join your objection, Judge.
Mr. Barrett, do you have a response?
I do, Judge. At the time that we were requested to submit pretrial information, we couldn't have contemplated all of the rebuttal that may be necessary from the direct examination that took place previously in this hearing. So the exhibits that Ms. Kingery is referring to are specifically to rebut the assertions made previously in the hearing that there was communication about the defects in the property.
You know, I am leaning towards not allowing them, and I'll tell you why. The pleadings have been here for a while. The arguments that have been made by these parties have been before the court for a good while. You would be hard-pressed to convince me that you could not have anticipated what was going to be stated. and what was going to be presented. And we have a reason for the pretrial information. That's so we can have some orderly orderly methods to the hearing so that we don't go on and go off on tangents and not stay focused on what the issues are. I am going to not allow the numerous exhibits. I kind of want to hear what exhibits at various points you would propose to enter. I don't want to summarily, Mr. Spears has objected to any exhibit because you didn't have any of them listed. And I don't want to rule summarily that they're not going to be allowed as rebuttal, but I want to know what they are.
Are you asking for by way of proper summary of what?
Yes, that will work.
Okay. Your Honor, the emails that I have are emails between Ms. Kingery there's a group of people copied on these, people who were following the transaction with the real estate. And they deal with initial listing price of the house, the issue with the defect or the perceived defect of the driveway. There was also another perceived defect with the setback where there was some concrete staircase that led up to the front of the house. Your Honor, there's also some photographic evidence that shows that the property still has the driveway and there's a new structure there and the driveway was not a defect that caused the impact of the center of the house.
I'm going to allow the communications that have to do with the notice and how soon she knew about or what notice she got regarding the tax issues, because the exemption had been withdrawn. There's information, presumably, that she wants to present, that you want to present, regarding the easement. But I'm not interested in the photographs to demonstrate that the easement or the driveway is still there and whether the present owners went through the process of filing whatever you need to file to have the easement declared void or whatever the case is you do with the city of Atlanta. I'm not interested in those photographs because I'm fully aware from all the testimony previously that ultimately the sale was agreed to. So I'm going to allow the information regarding how, when, and whether you knew about the tax exemption being withdrawn, etc. But no photographs regarding the current purchasers, the setback, etc.
About the driveway.
Is that the easement?
It's an alleyway. It's really not an easement. It was an abandoned alleyway.
No.
Judge, I can probably save the court a few minutes if I could take a few minutes of my client and call in our exhibits.
Okay.
That would be fine.
Yeah. So I'm going to allow you to kind of work through it.
This is my bad.
Yeah, sure. Yes.
Mr. Keener.
Thank you.
And I'm sure you'll explain to your client that she's not permitted to suggest what exhibit she wants to submit. Right. I know it's hard, but.
Be permissible if we just step outside so we can just decide what we do there.
Yeah,
you judge.
We'll take a 5-minute break.
Yes, thank you.
Thank you.
Jones?
Okay.
It's okay, I gave her the one that...
Oh, what for you?
Thank you.
You sure?
Yeah, I gave her the one that broke in this...
Is that enough? Okay. Welcome. I have more.
You don't have to have a leftover, you know, you can really get your own bottle.
I know, that's what I hesitated. I wasn't sure.
See, Miss Nydia needs one.
Nydia.
Nydia.
Nydia? With that N. Roger, Lydia.
Right? I was right, right? Her daughter's name Lydia.
You should remember. My daughter.
Yeah.
Judge Toomer, you may already be aware that the Council of Superior Court Judges is meeting today on St. Simon's Island.
Yes, they are.
And one of the items they're discussing under your agenda is a Rule 22. Mm-hmm. Yes, ma'am.
Yes.
Indeed. And I have posted extensively about that on my website, on my blog, and I just wanted to offer you my card in case you have any questions. And I've also video recorded... I've also video recorded the Court Reform Council, which was just created by Governor McIndian this spring, by executive order. And...
I heard about the Rule 22 meeting, that that was one of them they were taking up.
Yes, and so in the meeting a week ago with the Attorney General Chris Carr, one of my suggestions was that there would be a uniform rule regarding reporting in all classes of court throughout the state of Georgia, just so there's no confusion and broader, easier access for citizens and maybe more public. So I didn't want to show
that. Okay, well, I appreciate it. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you for allowing me to report.
Sure, sure.
Five, Your Honor, there's already a copy in evidence.
November 8, 2013 letter from Hamburger to attorneys.
Yes.
Okay, go ahead.
It's already admitted.
Already admitted?
Okay. Ms. Kingery, this is a letter, I'm gonna let you tell the court. When you receive this letter, what concerns did you have with it?
Yes, the letter is dated November 18, 2013. And when I saw this letter from the administrator, he was making it sound like the house will be foreclosed on. He's saying, and this is a, and there was another one as well. And as he's saying, I believe the defiance at cooperation with me was there with me, and it's interesting issue, I believe. Of the sale of the property is in the best interest of the estate after paying property taxes and after expenses. The estate account has 55.14.17. Accordingly, I had previously advised that we market the property to ensure the solvency of the estate. And this is not the letter that I'm referring to. There is another letter where he's saying time is of the essence, and he said, I asked the heirs to contribute $3,000, and the taxes have to be paid by January 2014, and if it's not, the house is going to be foreclosed on. However, what caught my attention with this letter was, if you look at second page, third paragraph up, where he says, before I can list property, we have to address the issue of title. Attached is a copy of report of title revised by Southeast Title and Process. Please note that I had the title report revised to correct an oversight by the examiner in the original report. This report confirms what we already knew, that there is a quitclaim deed from Graciela Alvarez reserving a life estate. Well, what I find interesting here, and after all this time, I have been deceived and lied to by the administrator, his counsel, Fredy Alvarez. There is no estate to Graciela Alvarez. There is an issue with the deed to the real estate property, which was and has been pending with this court since 2012, and it's still not resolved. In my pleadings, in some of my pleadings where I even submitted the abuse, and I explained in detail why Graciela Alvarez, when Fredy Alvarez accused me of having taken her accounts, I explained why she refused to leave them the money, why she refused and wanted to sell the house, and then found out she had been tricked because she was 87 years old, she did not speak English, she was forced in the car with him, took her to his office alone, and made her sign three documents. One of them was the deed. So there is no estate to Graciela Alvarez, and I've been lied to by this three attorneys that is fraud. Fraud, and I'm expecting
$100,000.
I beg your pardon, Your Honor. I'm thinking of my mother. I saw her die.
If you could just hold on for just a second.
I beg your pardon.
There's some tissues right beside you.
She was a mother.
With order. Your objection, Mr. Alvarez?
Your Honor.
All right.
Hearsay evidence, and certainly hopefully the court will not take that into consideration.
Your Honor, it's not hearsay. Here's the title to the property to the club.
You know how hard it is for you?
I'm sorry.
But you really have to be quiet. Mr. Barrett?
Yes, sir. Ms. Henry?
Give her a second. Compose yourself.
Sorry.
What we need you to do is just answer the questions. Just take a moment, and before you answer, answer the questions, and that's all I need you to do.
I'm so sorry. Go ahead, please.
All right.
Ms. King, the assertions in that letter and the other communications that you testified to, is that what led you to believe that there's a sense of urgency for a quick sale on the real estate?
No, there is another letter from the administrator to my attorney, and where he is explaining that he requested from the heirs to contribute $3,000 each, and it was not. And then he goes on to explain the taxes are due in January 2014, and if those taxes are not, in essence, what he's saying, and I can't quote verbatim, what he's saying in essence is, and he does end those payments of the essence, if the taxes are not paid, the property is going to be foreclosed on. And that's when I agreed. Let's say my parents' property that they worked so hard for.
All right, thank you.
Now, in addition to your dissatisfaction with the real estate transaction, you also have some dissatisfaction with the handling of your creditors' claim, is that correct?
Very much so.
And also, I know you're here first, so you heard the testimony. There's an issue about where your receipts and other items were located. You remember that testimony?
Yes, and I have an exhibit, which I believe we listed, which will show that the original documents were in the possession of the administrator all alone. He and his counsel repeatedly lied to me, saying, we don't have any, we just have copies, and if you want copies, you have to pay $125 for them. When I pressed them,
I want to show you a.
I received the originals.
Marked as a specific 31. You recognize that document?
Yes, I did. This is a document from Jeremy Meeser, and this is referring to the invoices.
Who was that? Who was that?
It's an email from
directed to whom?
To me. Copy and Mr. Harmon Caldwell. Brittany Carthers, that was his parody and his assistant.
Mr. Hammer, copy on that document?
No, he's not.
And is that a true and correct copy of the email that you received?
Yes, it is. And what it says?
Hold on a minute. I don't think he's even asking any other questions. Hold on.
Sorry.
No, I just wanted to identify the tender address before I can ask questions. Thank you very much.
Sorry, is the document intended? I just
it's not a letter. It's an email from Moser to Meeser. Is that his? Yeah.
Meeser.
Kingery. Meeser to Kingery.
What's the date on it?
Promoters, May 27, 2014.
I think we already may have that. Yeah. Okay.
Alright.
Okay.
Any
objection?
Yes, Your Honor. I object to the third paragraph of the letter, beginning to be clear. And I mean, the rest of it, it's all hearsay, but that's part that I really object to, because it is a statement by a person who is not in court, offering to prove the truth of what was said. Your site, I think that takes the whole document out.
There.
Your Honor, I said it for the purposes of demonstrating a rebutting earlier testimony that Ms. Kingery had not provided the documentation for her credit score to the administrator.
All right. Ms. Alvarez, you had an objection.
He's totally here to say, and he, that's communication between her attorney and has nothing to do with the testimony that was previously given.
Your Honor, it's the very last sentence in that paragraph. Because if that's not offered to prove the truth of what is said, I don't know what it is. And that brings it right within the hearsay. Mr. Meeser's not here. Mr. Hamburg has testified about things being available and agreed with the counsel not to review things until there was money to pay. But this is I still object to the hearsay contained within the last sentence of the third paragraph.
Sustained.
Go on.
Yes, sir.
Ms. Kingery, you also expressed dissatisfaction with the administrator's refusal to respond to your request about his fees.
Correct.
Tell the court about the communications you had with him and regarding the fee.
For 3 years, or perhaps two, I can't remember, but repeatedly, and I believe this was an exhibit that we listed, repeatedly I requested from the administrator that he provide me with an estimate of how much his fees and expenses were, and more specifically, I did this on May 15th. Of 2014. The reason I was requesting it, I said, you have 2 days to provide me with that. Well, by this point, I had spoken to Mr. Craig Jones to represent me in the trial of the estate court, and of course, I had no money. So I wanted to know how much, to have an idea of how much would be left in the estate so that I could have Mr. Jones give him the assurance that he would be paid out of my portion of the estate whenever I received the estate. The administrator and his counsel repeatedly, over and over, said, you have no right, you will find out when we request it from the court. I was quite shocked and very hurt because I thought, well, I thought we were supposed to communicate. I thought the administrator, not that I expected him to be my best friend, but I expected, this is my parents' estate. I assume we would be able to talk at least about things like this. And as I said, that is what prompted me, among other things. He's just denial to communicate with me. He's abused. Even taking the key, I have been taking care of the property, my parents' property, since my mother passed, and even before. Mr. Alvarez refused to pay for it.
Unresponsive.
It is utterly unresponsive. Next question.
Yes, sir. You had expressed concern over the added estate expenses because Mr. Spears was hired to represent the administrator. Tell the court what you do about that.
Yes, I believe that is totally an unnecessary expense. And the reason when Mr. Spears first came on the scene, which was on May 15th, when I sent an email, I had just spoken to Mr. Craig Jones and I sent another email to the administrator requesting, well, please let me give me an idea of how much your fees are to date and how much your expenses, and the only issue at the time was Mr. Hamburg's delay in refusal to consider my creditor's claim for expenses, which was about $16,000. And I was at this point just totally living on loans. I had gone through my 401k, etc. So I objected repeatedly to the fact that there was no reason. Starting my counsel, they said, you need to take this to court.
Move to strike the last thing, Your Honor. Is there a second? Counsel told me we need to take this to court. That's totally beyond the scope of what's going on in this issue.
He'll be stricken.
Okay.
Next question.
Yes, sir.
I'll be stricken. I'll be considering it anyway. Sustained.
Thank you.
You also expressed dissatisfaction about some of the claims that were assigned to your brother by the administrator.
Yes, I did.
Okay.
I objected to them, and the reason was that there were no pleadings filed whatsoever on these claims. They were barred by time, each and every one of them, and they specifically mirror my claims in the state court, such as battery. It was like a mockery with no, and we objected to the administrator repeatedly, and I felt that it was even disrespectful to this court to attach such an email knowing being an attorney, knowing that there were no legal basis whatsoever. And well, I felt very strongly.
Well, Your Honor, I'm sorry, I keep popping up, and I hate to do this, and I apologize, Mr. Fair. But Claims Exhibit 21 is a consent order on assignment of claims. And those are the claims that Ms. Kingery is talking about. It's consented to by Mr. Deaver and Mr. Caldwell and Mr. Meeser and their attorneys for Mrs. Kingery. And I know the assignment of the claims in the state court was done, to the state court was done by order of this court in December of 2013. I think this has no probative value, and it's moot. I object to the testimony on it.
Ma'am. Sustained.
Thank you.
Go ahead, Ms. Barrett.
Yes, sir. You had one of the issues that you believe is you express dissatisfaction about is the nature of the real estate transaction and the purchaser. What you believe about that? What do you believe? What is the basis for your belief?
I know, although I haven't been able to, we were not allowed to conduct discovery, that Fredy Alvarez has purchased the property, and the reason the property was sold so under, well over $100,000 below market value, and the reason I was lied to about the driveway, which by the administrator and Fredy Alvarez, was because it was Fredy Alvarez's intentions, and since my mother was alive, and that's why he did what he did with the deed, to keep that house. And actually, I have not seen the actual survey because we were not able to, again, to do discovery, or even we received five offers. From $435,000 to $425,000 to $390,000 to $410,000, and these are not just plain offers, these are contracts to purchase. And each and every one, these were investors, used the same reason, except for the first one who said the cell tower and the driveway. They said because of the driveway, and there are numerous emails in here from the real estate agent saying it's the driveway, and that's the reason it's so below.
Hold on. I'm sorry, I objected to what the emails say. The emails haven't been admitted. And it's again, it's what someone else says. Thank you.
If I may add,
I
go ahead, Mr. Barrett, go ahead and respond.
The offers that she's talking about were also part of the direct testimony.
They were.
That's my response.
Okay. But the emails are not part of anything that the court's going to look at or accept anyway.
I understand that.
Go ahead.
Ms. Alvarez, your brother, you know, one of the other parties in this case, he's a licensed attorney in Georgia. Is that right?
Yes, he is.
And you feel that's been you at a disadvantage in this litigation?
Absolutely. I'm a woman. He is that. I've always been a huge ego. I'm just a little nobody. And he's with big-time lawyers. And frankly, that has been my contention with the administrators since day one. I've been deceived every step of the way by this administrator, his counsel, and Fredy Alvarez. My mother was taken.
Thank you.
You've had to employ counsel to represent you in this case part of the time. You did part of the pro se, correct?
I did when I ran out of money. You're the sixth attorney I have had, and the reason I have had to do that is because of the attorneys I've had have become cronies.
Hold on, Ms. King.
I'm trying to protect.
Hold on, I need to hear the objection.
The objection, the question was you had to employ counsel. She said yes, and then went on. I object to everything after yes, and she should be able to ask her another question. We're getting long narratives that require me to interrupt her, and I ask that she respond to the question and let her be proper.
Sustained. Go ahead, Mr. Barrett. Next question.
Yes, Judge. approximately how much have you spent on attorney's fees in this litigation?
I have it here, not including the state court fees, I can give you the exact amount if you'll give me 1 second. I have every bill here itemized.
Well, let me ask you individually.
I'm sorry, $104,280.76. And in filing fees with this
Thank
court,
you. Next question. Mr. Alvarez, anything on cross? One question, okay.
Mrs. Kingery, do you have any personal knowledge?
Yeah.
Or just the property that our parents have?
I do, actually, the building permit, in addition to having heard it through several people, through other people, but the building permit, which I have a picture here, of the property when it was demolished and being built, was under my parents' name, Federico and Alvarez. I went to the building, of Atlanta, and I complained. I said, how can this be in my parents' name when my parents have been deceased and that house was sold? They said, well, whoever filled out the application, use that name.
Don't tell me what they said.
Okay.
I want you, do you have the building permit with you?
Yes, I do.
Does my name appear in the building permit?
No, but my parents, and then, obviously, the
okay.
next.
Thank you. Is Mr. Fredy Alvarez is not on the building permit?
No, he's not.
Thank you,
Jeff.
That's all.
All right. Mr. Spears?
Ms. Alvarez, my name is John Spears. We've met a couple of times before. I'm going to do my best to be very brief. You work in law offices before?
Yes.
Did you work for DISCHARGED? people other than Dr. Stephen Federal?
Yes, I've been a translator for apparently 35 years.
So you've been a paralegal?
Both, mostly translator.
What is a verification?
A verification when you're swearing to a fact, to a statement.
So I'm going to hand you what's been marked minus to the 34.
Sure.
One. This is an exemplified copy of the verified complaint filed in state court.
Correct.
That's for you. That's a certified copy I'd like to tender in evidence.
Any objection? This is a state court complaint?
Yes, Your Honor.
Okay.
Probative value would be related to, I would say, paragraph 1.
Yeah, I see a copy of it, the one you have.
This is the state court one, Mr. Alvarez, I'm sorry.
Paragraph 1. No objections, you got it.
Yes.
No question about it. Paragraph 1. Plaintiff, that's you, is that correct?
That's right.
Is the personal representative of the estate of her mother, Graciela Alvarez. And then gives her date of death. That's what it says in here, correct?
That's correct.
And you verified that. In other words, you swore it was true.
My attorney used that term and I felt like I am and was her personal representative. She left her estate to me, which doesn't exist.
And the last page of Exhibit 30 is a notarized verification, which you swore that everything in that complaint is true to the best of your knowledge.
Yes, sir.
Unless otherwise stated.
Yes, sir.
That's all that happened.
Thank you. You can step down. You've already asked questions. You have. You can step down. Just watch your step down. Get off the little edge. Keep it brief if you don't mind.
Your Honor, the court records, the docket, the case summary has exhibited P28 and P29. The evidence submitted in the testimony of the administrator, his attorney, my testimony, and the testimony of Mr. Craig Jones. Shows the court that the administrator was appointed with the consent of the heirs. I filed a claim for reimbursement of my father's funeral expenses. Mrs. Kingery filed an objection. She filed a claim to be reimbursed for expenses that she had paid to the from the estate of my mother. I filed an objection. On March 27, 2014, the administrator sends a letter to both parties saying, this is what I'm gonna do. I propose to do this. And that's Exhibit Fredy 2, Your Honor. This is how I would pay the claims. This is how I propose to resolve the year's claims. The only claims of the state, because there was nothing else. Fredy Alvarez produces what is requested from him, and that is a signature card within 10 days, as indicated in the letter. Mrs. Kingery claims that for Mrs. Kingery's claim for expenses, A, B, C, D, all the stuff that she had claimed, are disallowed by the administrator. He says, no, I'm not going to pay those. Mrs. Kingery's other claims, and I call them X, Y, and Z, the administrator says, if you produce proof, I will pay it. You got 10 days to prove it as well. I submitted the signature card promptly within those 10 days. Mrs. Kingery did not. In the meantime, Your Honor, the administrator assigned to each heir at their request and the request of the attorneys, a claim for battery, undue influence, conversion of funds alleged by each one against each other. The cases go to the state court. There are complaints and counterclaims in the state court. The state court of Fulton County, a ton of discovery was filed. Back and forward, the case lasted a long time. On August 18, 2014, the parties represented by competent lawyers, very competent lawyers, with the state court judge, Judge Eady, mediating the dispute, agreed to settle. And that would be Freddie's Exhibit 1. They agreed to settle. And they agreed to settle the state court case and the probate court case, their objections that they had to the administrator's proposal. They say, okay, we're going to let the administrator do whatever the administrator wants to do. Mr. Craig Jones testified here in the police court that that was settled as well. And that is paragraph F1. Paragraph 1 of that settlement agreement. The that paragraph run and says the plaintiff and the defendant should share equally the proceeds of the state property contained within the state of Federico Alvarez and Graciela Alvarez. We agree that 50-50 less any expenses awarded by the administrator. It's a text in the affidavit submitted by Mr. Craig Jones and his testimony, he says that he acknowledged from his client that he was in disagreement with the administrator regarding the way the administrator was paying the expenses. That was resolved there. We said in that agreement, and we knew what the administrator intended to do with those claims. That's the letter previously sent that Freddy's to proposed how he was going to do it. He was going to resolve everything. So in that settlement, we agreed. Now, within a few days of reaching that agreement, Your Honor, settling that, getting that document, Freddy won, I sent a objection. I filed an objection with this court, telling this court, I object for the administrator to resign from the case. And this is why I don't want the administrator to resign. Previously, the administrator had filed a petition to resign. He says he had too much work. And I said, I object for the administrator to resign. That's part of the record. And I argue that the motion, on that motion, that the heirs have settled their objection to each other's claim for expenses, and that we have decided how we're going to divide the corpus of the state, that the heirs will abide by your decision on how you will apportion the expenses. See Friday 2. You are familiar with the state, and you have all the files, the records, you know what this case is all about. A new administrator is going to be costly for the state, more expenses. All you have to do is a final tax report, file the returns, the publications, and do the things that you are obligated by statute to do in order to settle the state. The heirs have consented. And what the administrator had to do after August 2014 when we submitted that document, Your Honor, is what he would have to do when he gets the final order from this court. Nothing else. Your Honor, in 2014, the estate should have been closed. That's it. What did not happen was that Mrs. Kingery, on August 18, 2014, when she walked out of that courtroom, she changed her mind. She didn't want that settlement to be a settlement. She didn't want to recognize it. And as Mr. Spears testified, everything exploded. Everything exploded. I refer, Your Honor, to exhibits P28 and P29, which are the case summaries from both states here regarding the activity that occurred from that point forward. There were pleading after pleading filed by Mrs. Kingery, bogus and frivolous, motions, response to motions, response to the response to the motion, and discovery requests when there was no need to file discovery because the discovery period had ended and the discovery had been taken place already by her competent lawyers. And that would be Mr. Caldwell and Mr. Miser. Email after email to the administrator, and he needed to respond. Finding cause of the state. The administrator had to charge the state for doing his function. The attorney for the administrator had to do the same thing. Had to bill the state. And bring in new claims. She even wrote a new claim as a executor of DESON, D-E-S-O-N. Indicating that she should have been paid for her own administrations, as indicated in the last exhibit that the court produced and administrator submitted to the court, where she proclaimed to be an administrator, an executor, and that she needed to be paid by the state. She refused to produce proof of the claims that she had been requested and demanded payment, as Mr. Hamburg testified, for her time and the copy in producing what he was asking to produce in order to satisfy those claims that he had decided that he would pay to her. Causing the administrator to file and attend a hearing on the motion for declaratory judgment. And not producing the documents until the day prior to the hearing, as he said, Mr. Spears testified. She just fought it all the way, causing the state expenses. Objecting to the administrator's proposed distribution of the expenses as previously agreed. And waiting until the hearing, the very same day of the hearing, to dismiss her petition for the new claim as a second to this one. She has, Your Honor, boycotted her attendance to the closing of the house. The sale of the house, practically the only asset that the state had, after having signed voluntarily with her attorney next to her, being represented by a competent lawyer, a sales contract. She agreed to sell the house. And Your Honor, and that is Exhibits PA, which is the contract, and P9, the emails, and P10, the letter from the administrator. She refused to attend the closing, and she made threat to the administrator unless I am paid for my claims, I will not go to the closing. So the administrator had to dedicate time in writing a letter, emails, going back and forth and saying, if you don't attend, the estate's going to be sued for a specific performance by a buyer, and Mr. Alvarez will be sued too, and you will be sued as well. Well, that costs the estate hundreds of dollars in administration expenses. When she could not get her way, and she had to attend the closing of the property, she said, okay, you're doing this to me? I'm going to report you, administrator, to the State Bar of Georgia for ethics violation. Your Honor, also, she has tried to influence by intimidating the court because she did not like the outcome of the order granting declaratory judgment on February 10, 2016 by reporting Your Honor to the Commission for Ethics Violation. And I testified before, Your Honor, she tried to have me arrested so that I could lose my license to practice law as a result of the conviction of crimes of moral turpitude. Thank God it didn't happen, because there was nothing that I've done. I submitted the all the time dedicated and billed by the administrators dealing with Mrs. Kingery for the refusal to attend the closing of the state's real property, the only asset of the state. And 80%, as I testified, of the billing since August 18, 2014, when we settled the case in the state court, renouncing to the objections and saying whatever the administrator wants to do, he's fine with us. He already told us in Fredy's Exhibit 2 how he proposes to do. He said, the time that he dedicated, the attorney's fee dedicated, and billed to this case, as shown in Exhibits P1A and P1B by the administrator's expense report, and Exhibits P25A and P25B, which are Mr. Spears' billing to the state time report. And Your Honor, also including expenses as shown in Exhibits 26A and 26B, expenses incurred by the state, including the tax preparation for the year 2015, it should never have happened, 2016 and now 2017, filing fees filed by the state, copies, courier fees, and so forth, as Mr. Spear has shown in those reports, and all the filing fees that have paid with the court as shown in the clerk's record and in the summary reports since August 2014 should be cast against Ms. Kingery. Over, and Your Honor, not only against her, but against her portion of the state. As prayed by the administrator in the pleadings, his attorney fees and the prayers of his pleading, his attorney, where he prays that she pays for his attorney fees, and as I prayed by me in my heir, Fredy M. Alvarez, response to administrator's petition for final settlement of accounts in approval of final distribution plan, Your Honor, we submit the pursuant to OCDA sections 9-11-9-68 and 13-6-11, Ms. Kingery's abuse of this process has been based on frivolous claims, based on position, lacking substantial justification, and made in bad faith, with malice or wrongful purposes. Mrs. Kingery's conduct in these proceedings has been in bad faith and has been stubbornly vicious Her conduct has been outrageous. Her ignorance of naiveness is not an excuse. Neither is a factor in these proceedings. Her pleadings, letters, and emails have been knowingly and well prepared. She has been represented, as I testified, by 8 attorneys, and she testified there are at least 6 attorneys during the course of these disputes. She was well advised. Whether Your Honor accepts Fredy 1 as a settlement of Mrs. Kingery's refusal to abide by his terms and the litigation in 2014 or not, her legal conduct on itself shall make Mrs. Kingery solely responsible for those costs, expenses, administration, and attorney fees that the administrator and I have prayed for, not estates of Federico and Graciela Alvarez. Thank you, Your Honor.
Thank you.
Your Honor, my closing will be a bit more brief than Mr. Alvarez. As the court well knows, estates many times are emotional. We've seen some emotions today. They involve people who know each other very well. They know how to push each other's buttons. And when money's involved, sometimes they have the motivation to do that, Judge. And this is a situation where Mr. Alvarez wants to point to Ms. Kingery and say, you're the source of all the issues that we have to litigate in this case. And that's just simply not true. That's not what the evidence has been before the court over the course of the last 2 days we've litigated this case. He has maintained to the court, even just now in his closing argument, Your Honor, he's trying to convince this court that somehow more was settled in the state court case than the state court claims. And that's just simply not true. That's not what the documents say. You heard testimony from the attorney for Mr. Skinner today. State court claims were settled in the state court. And that didn't come over to the probate court judge. And his assertion was that they did, and somehow that they should cause Ms. Kingery to abandon her creditor claims. It's just not, it's not true. And that's, Your Honor, I would suggest is bad faith, is several litigious. Your Honor, this estate's been up for a long time. And people get impatient in situations like this. You know, Ms. Kingery, she waited a long time to have her creditors claim back. She waited more than most lay people would expect that a probate case would ever need to end. I know there's extenuating circumstances that the court sees sometimes, but there's really not any of those in this case. I think the only real the only thing that could possibly extended for a period of time the time to close the estate was if the real estate hadn't sold. The real estate sold in about 5 months or so. Now, Ms. Kingery, she's a lay person. She's worked at some law firms, so she's not a lawyer, and she's not a match for her brother who's been practicing law for many years, probably as long as I have. You know, I've never been acquainted with him before, but he seems to be a nice, accomplished lawyer. But she's not a match for that, and it really costs her in this case. You heard her testimony about the amount of legal fees that she spent in this case, Judge, and it's slightly more than $100,000. And I tell you, Judge, she didn't include the money fees, which as of today is approximately $8,000, depending on how much the petition to pay the court will receive at the end. Your Honor, she has some legitimate issues with the way this estate was administered. Your Honor, you heard from her directly, you heard my cross-examination questions, that there appeared to be an artificial sense of urgency to move the real estate. I understand that the administrator wants to get paid in the case, but there seems to have been issues related to alleged defects in the property that weren't defended by the administrator. And based on the testimony of the administrator of the offers being over $400,000 initially, and then the house up to $359,000, Your Honor, that's a pretty significant margin that should justify trying to defend the defects in the property. You also heard testimony and you saw the documentary evidence about the issues with the real estate taxes. I think it caught everyone by surprise, although it probably shouldn't have, but it did, that the loss of the homestead exemption for several years is going to cause a retroactive tax. No argument about whether that's proper or improper. I think it is, but it did create an issue where the state was short funds to actually pay the real estate taxes. And Your Honor, that created a sense or a communication that was interpreted by Mrs. Kingery as there's an impending tax, so oh my gosh, we've got to do something to sell this house. Your Honor, what I expect you to be deciding today is whether or not to accept the final statement of accounts of the administrator in this state. Make a determination about the appropriateness of his fees and his request for additional compensation, and make a determination on how the remaining proceeds of the estate are going to be divided. Judge would ask that you divide the proceeds of the estate, the net estate, 50-50 between two heirs. Your Honor, Ms. Kingery maintains her objection to the fees of the administrator and for his request for additional compensation.
Thank you. Mr. Spears?
Thank you, Your Honor. I'm going to address a few more things in the talk. I'll try to be very brief. I know you take good notes. It's a couple of counseling things at the beginning. I understood Alvarez to say that the administrator had requested a disposition that there was some skewing of the fees and cost of fees toward the system. That is not in there. If I misunderstood you, Mr. Alvarez, I apologize. That is not in the petition for final settlement or the petition for account. That is not something that the administrator has requested. What Your Honor does with that is up to you. There might be a question as to what was P30 about? P30 was the verified complaint in state court, which is dated about 14 months before any petition in this court was ever made to appoint Mrs. Kingery as an administrator of the state, and in fact she was never appointed as administrator or personal representative of the state. The appropriate code section defining personal representative includes administrator, executor, administrator, with willingness. And that was the point of Exhibit 30. It was verified through the sworn statement to be something that she was not and had not been appointed by the court. With respect to the real estate value, I think Mr. Gimber testified a lot about the problems that existed that were discovered as I went along. One of those references, including a structural reference, is included in, I guess, the final sales contract, which is number 8. Talks about you have to move the house to fix the structure. This fourth again was a letter from letter, and that was the basis for extending some of the due diligence claims. In fact, Your Honor, I have looked and looked and looked, and I cannot find any reference to any complaint about the sales price in any pleading filed in this court until April 8th, 2016, which is, I think, later, 2 years after contract was signed, the listing was signed, the contract was done, and the closing was held. There have been complaints about my client, but the fact of the matter is, maybe it's a problem when you represent yourself, but there has been no petition filed to remove him. There has been no petition for accounting and settlement. If you think you're entitled to know what's going on, you don't know what's going on fast enough, the simple solution with the court is file one of those petitions, and neither were both, and neither one was filed. So him do. He took over, he stepped into this case, and he stepped into litigation between a brother and a sister. He see negative field of dealing with how that feels. But the litigation had been going on for several years openly before he came into this case, and it continued after his appointment. He acted appropriately to move this estate forward. He got with signed claims. He sold the car. He donated the car and distributed the property. He had the title examined. He had the income taxes checked to see about these people filing. The house was appraised. The house was listed and sold. And this estate is ready to be closed. And we filed a petition for declaratory judgment that cleaned out all the other things. All that's remaining is to give him, or I ask initially, that clear path to close this estate that needs to be closed. Unfortunately, we haven't been able to do that without litigation in each instance. I think you've got notes about what my fees requested are, what Mr. Amberg's fees are, and the fee structure compensation. The one thing that I would ask is that you consider increasing the requested reserve from $3,500 per estate to $10,000 per estate. Based on my assessment of the history of this case, it would not be surprising to find that even while we've got a big record, we have lots of costs. And that's the only way I find that these things can be protected if an appeal is taken and if the court order is upheld. It's going to be 9 months down the road with no way to reopen that. Thank you very much for your attention, Your Honor. I appreciate it.
Thank you. Well, I will consider everything I've heard here for the last several days. And I did note that I was a little surprised that the administrator asked to set aside $3,500 to close out the estate if we got to a closing. I thought that was pretty ambitious, given the litigation that has gone on in this matter. I'll consider what I've heard. And there is something in one of your prayers, Mr. Hamburg, about splitting fees or something, but I can't remember.
I can't
remember everything, but I think I saw a reference to it, but none of it matters at this point because I'm going to consider everything I've gotten anyway and what I've heard here today. And I certainly will look at the prayers, consider the evidence that's been presented.
Your Honor, may I cite the document to make it easier in court finding?
No, you don't need to. I think I know where it is.
My file of May 4, 2017. Yes,
that's correct. It is. There's a reference to fees, but I'll look at it. And what you thought should be, I think there's a response that was filed. Okay. So there were lots of responses to each other's pleadings in these matters. Thank you all. I think this matter is concluded for free today. Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
I appreciate your time. I'm sorry we just got to, sometimes it's just unfortunate that we get to this kind of litigation, but this is what we do. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Congrats.
Thanks.
You missed the exit right here.
The elevator's in that direction. Oh, he's here, isn't he?
The elevator's that way.
Thank you, Mr. Spears.
Thank you, Mr. Alvarez. I
know that you need to say your piece.
Normally, I attach the originals to a transcript. And the judge wants to give you a number.